Calvinists are often called the frozen chosen. Become a Calvinist, you won't care about evangelism anymore. Become a Calvinist and you won't care about missions anymore. Become a Calvinist and you will no longer have a strong prayer life. Become a Calvinist and you won't care much about holiness. Become a Calvinist and eventually you will lose the joy of your personal relationship with Jesus Christ. These are but a few of the stereotypical things that have been said to my face as one being a Calvinist. But here's what I have found. I have found that most of these accusations that I have heard come from a misunderstanding about what Calvinism is and what it teaches. Because the actual history of Calvinism, including what Calvinists have consistently written, preached, prayed, sung, and witnessed, does not fit the stereotype that has been formulated by many non-Calvinists. We're focusing on this in our Reform series because it's very important that we have a consistent theology when it comes to God's sovereignty and salvation. Let me repeat that. The reason why we are focusing on Calvinism in our Reform series is because it is of vital importance that we have a consistent theology when it comes to God's sovereignty and salvation. Calvinism is best understood by the acronym TULIP. T-U-L-I-P. The T stands for total depravity. That's what we will deal with next week, Lord willing. The U stands for unconditional election. The L stands for limited atonement. The I stands for irresistible grace. And the P stands for perseverance of the saint. These five doctrines teach a consistent presentation of salvation from the Bible. We want consistency in Scripture, do we not?
Yes.
Now here's the question. Why is it called Calvinism? Why is it called Calvinism? Well, first of all, Calvinism is simply a nickname. Don't get all caught up in the word Calvinism. It's a nickname. Okay? It is shorthand for a set of beliefs. And I've had people say to me, well, I don't like labels. I really just don't like labels. And I'll say, well, are you a Christian? Oh, yeah. Label. Are you a Baptist? Well, absolutely. Label. See, we don't really have a problem with labels. We have a problem with labels that we don't understand. All right? So Calvinism is simply shorthand for a set of beliefs about the sovereignty of God and salvation. I am a Christian, Southern Baptist, Calvinist or Reformed, and I am a amillennialist. And you're like, why do we have all these labels? Well, I can either give you the shorthand or I can spend the next 47 hours explaining to you what I believe. So Calvinism is simply a nickname or shorthand to quickly say to somebody, here's what I believe about God's sovereignty and salvation. And if people know what Calvinism is, they understand that that nickname or that shorthand just helps us communicate and put ourselves in a position that hopefully will help. There were Calvinists before John Calvin. Okay? Augustine was a Calvinist. But of course, Calvin hadn't come yet, so that nickname hasn't been used. But Augustine believed what I'm going to be teaching about salvation. All right? I will be arguing that Paul and Jesus believed in Calvinism. Calvinism's just a nickname. It's just shorthand. Let me read you what Charles Spurgeon said. Probably the most, well, not probably, the most respected Baptist ever to live. Here's what he said. I have my own private opinion that there is no such thing as preaching Christ and Him crucified unless we preach what nowadays is called Calvinism. It is a nickname to call it Calvinism, but Calvinism is the gospel and nothing else.
That's right.
The reason why it is called nickname, the reason why it's nicknamed Calvinism is because of what happened over 400 years ago. There was a man by the name of Jacob Arminius. He began teaching a set of doctrines that were contrary to the Protestant Reformation. Now that's important. Okay? All of this history work that we've done in this series about all these great reformers and how they stood on the Word of God and they stood on the five solas that we talked about. Those men began teaching the gospel, and they did it for about 100 years. And then Jacob Arminius comes along and he begins teaching doctrines that were contrary to the Protestant Reformation. That is so important. So vitally important that we understand that. It was all based around this issue of salvation. Jacob Arminius had some followers that came up with 5 points. Here were their 5 points. 1, human free will. This states that though man is fallen, he is not incapable or he's not incapacitated by his sinful nature, and he can freely choose God. Listen to this. He is not restricted or enslaved by his sin nature. Red flags and bells ought to be popping like crazy right now. They did it for the reformers. The second was conditional election. God chose people for salvation based on his foreseeing and God looking into the future to see how men would respond to the gospel. So here's how election worked. God would look down the corridors of time. He would see who would choose him and then he would choose them. Makes no sense. Universal atonement. The position that Jesus bore the sin of every single person who has ever lived. Resistible grace. The teaching that the grace of God, the salvific grace of God, can be resisted and finally beaten so as to reject salvation in Christ. And lastly, fall from grace. This is the teaching that a person can fall from grace and lose their salvation. These 5 points were put together by Jacob Arminius, really by his followers. And they took, that's where we get the term Arminianism. They took these 5 points and they began teaching these 5 points contrary to the doctrines of the Protestant Reformation on salvation. The Protestant Reformation had been teaching the doctrines of the nickname Calvinism for 100 years. And now there was this teaching that was going on that flew in the face of what the Reformation had been teaching. So in 1618 and 1619, an international synod, a synod is a gathering of pastors, an international synod was called. It was called the Synod of Dort in the Netherlands. Here, pastors gathered from all over the place. They came together to discuss the issue of salvation as a way of responding to what they believed was false teaching that was being called Arminianism. So they came up with the canons of Dort, which we now commonly refer to as the 5 points of Calvinism. So no one called themselves a Calvinist because they followed John Calvin. No one called themselves a Calvinist because they said, well, we don't want to follow Jesus. We want to follow a man. We want to follow John Calvin. No, they believed what they believed, and what was laid out at the Synod of Dort, they thoroughly believed and completely believed it was biblical. What we have been teaching on salvation for 100 years, we've been teaching it because we believe in sola scriptura. We believe that we get our doctrine of salvation from God's word and God's word alone. It is our final authority. So we can come up with the 5 points of Arminianism and we can use all this language, but what it really comes down to is what does God's word say? And the Synod of Dort came together with all these pastors and they said, this Arminianism stuff flies in the face of scripture. Losing your salvation, being able to, when God sets out to do something, being able to thwart his will with your will. That is not what Scripture teaches. And so they begin to lay out these 5 points. So here's what we need to understand. The 5 points of Calvinism came about as a response to the 5 points of Arminianism. Calvinists didn't get together and say, let's come up with a wonderful acronym that we can teach people. That's not what was happening. Do you know how quote unquote Calvinism was being spread? As Protestant reformers taught the Word of God. That's how it got spread. They didn't put a system together. They were simply preaching the Word of God and believing these things about the sovereignty of God and salvation and God's work in men and that God's will can't be thwarted and His decree is eternal. They believed all these things because they were simply teaching Scripture until these people came up with 5 points of Arminianism that flew in the face of what they had been teaching from God's Word. And so they responded with the 5 points of Calvinism. I've actually heard somebody say, well, the problem I have with Calvinists is because they're following a man and not God. You just don't know your history. You simply do not know your history. All of the Protestant reformers that we went through, Martin Luther, Zwingli, Calvin, Knox. You know, remember the 8 weeks that we did all the history? All right? I stand, and this pastoral staff stands with all of those men when it comes to the doctrine of salvation. Amen. If you ask any pastor who's the greatest pastor ever to live, the greatest Baptist pastor ever to live, 99.999999999% of them are going to say Charles Spurgeon. I and this pastoral staff stand where Charles Spurgeon stands on the doctrine of salvation.
Right, that's right.
This is not new. This is not some young movement in America. You know, there was this movement called the Young Restless and Reform Movement about 10 years ago that kind of came about. And this is not some new thing. All right? I could bring books in here and hold up the books. Jonathan Edwards and Charles Spurgeon and Augustine and Calvin and Luther and Bunyan and Knox and Whitfield. I could be holding the books up and say, read what these great Protestant reformers believed about salvation. And when you're done, you'll know where I stand. You'll know where the pastoral staff stands. So, it's vitally important that we get the history. And we don't have time to go through all this, but we need to understand the history of all this. So that people can't say, oh, we know all those Calvinists, they follow John Calvin, not Jesus. And you can look at them and say, you just don't know what you're talking about. I don't like titles. And they're American, they're Christian, they're Baptist, they're golfers. You can't get away from titles. One of those will make you lose your salvation. Because you will get out there on that golf course and cuss and stuff like David Conrad. But before we get into the actual 5 points, which we will start next week, we must discuss the sovereignty of God. You cannot begin discussing the 5 points of Calvinism until you discuss the decree and the sovereignty of God. You just can't do it. If we can't agree on the sovereignty of God, then we're certainly not going to agree on how God works salvation. What does the Bible say about God's control over the affairs of what happens on the earth? So let's first talk about the sovereignty of God. This is where your notes will pick up. Did we pass out the notes tonight? David, will you grab those and see if anybody else... Just raise your hand if you need a page so we can make sure... There's tons of Bible references on there. Some I will read, some I won't. So you might need that. As David's passing that around, I want you to listen to the words of A.W. Pink on the sovereignty of God. Famous Baptist pastor. He might be second after Spurgeon, by the way. Being infinitely elevated above the highest creature... God is the Most High, Lord of heaven and Lord of earth, subject to no one, influenced by no one, absolutely independent, God does as he pleases and only as he pleases. None can thwart him and none can hinder him. Amen. If we can't aim in that, what are we doing? Mm-hmm. Let me read it again. Being infinitely elevated above the highest creature, he is the Most High, Lord of heaven and earth, subject to no one, influenced by none, absolutely independent. God does as he pleases and only as he pleases. None can thwart him and none can hinder him. Isaiah chapter 46 verse 10 says this, declaring the end from the beginning and from ancient times, things not yet done, saying, my counsel shall stand, and I will accomplish all my purposes. Now, let me ask you a question. If God purposes to do something, can he fail to accomplish what he purposes?
No.
It's important. That's an important answer. It's a very, very important answer. Because there are many people out there who are truly born-again Christians. I'm not doubting anybody's salvation. They are truly born-again Christians who believe that the purposes of God can be thwarted upon the earth.
Oh, no.
Psalm 135. If you can keep up with me, keep up with me. I'm not really going to wait. There's so many that I want to look at. Psalm 135, verses 5 and 6. For I know that the Lord is great, and that our Lord is above all gods. Whatever the Lord pleases, he does, in heaven and on earth, in the seas and all the deeps. Anything that God pleases to do, he does it, and he gets it done. Divine sovereignty means that God is, in fact, God, in his name and in his actions, that he is on the throne of the universe, directing all things and working all things according to the counsel of his will. Ephesians chapter 1 verse 11 says that very thing. Ephesians chapter 1 verse 11. In him we have obtained an inheritance, having been predestined according to the purpose of him who works all things according to the counsel of his will. We are told in Hebrews chapter 1 and Colossians 1:17 that God upholds everything in himself and that it is all through his power. God upholds everything, specifically in both Hebrews and Colossians. Jesus upholds everything by the word of his power. He is in control of all things. Now, I want to give you three specific things that God is in control of. They're there in your notes. They'll be up on the screen. Number one, God controls nature. God controls nature. I didn't even put any Bible verses for this one because I'm thinking, my goodness, God's in charge of nature. He's in charge of tornadoes and hurricanes and waves and rain. And why in the world would the people of the Old Testament pray to God for rain? Because they knew he's in charge of the rain. He's in charge of all of nature. You know, one of the most remarkable, I mean, of course, we know the story of Jesus, right? When he talks to the waves and the wind and they stop. I mean, we're talking about being in control. You talk to the waves and they obey. I also find it fascinating in the story of Noah. God sends the animals two by two to Noah. He didn't send 5,000 of a creature. He sent two by two. And guess what? The two that he called came to the ark.
That's right.
It's because God's in charge of nature. He created it. He created all of it. He speaks to water, he speaks to wind, to birds, to frogs, to bread, to fish. Whatever God says, it does. It does. Animals don't say to God, nah, don't think so. Wind doesn't say to God, nah, don't think so. God controls all of nature. When he wants a sea to part, a sea parts. You know, you're crazier than that. When he wants a donkey to talk, a donkey will talk.
Right.
Why? Because he's in charge of nature. Number two, God controls people. Now we usually don't have a problem when discussing people who obey God. And we'll say, oh no, that was the Lord in me. Right? Nobody says, yeah, I mean, nobody in their right mind says, oh yeah, look what I did for God. I did this all by myself. No, if we do something that is good and praiseworthy and of spiritual affirmation and wonderful, then we always give the credit to God, don't we?
Yes.
Because we know it's God working in me to do these things. The fact that I loved my neighbor is because the Lord moved in me to love my neighbor. He empowered me to get it done. We don't have a problem speaking that way because I think most of us know that that's true. It's the verse that we've quoted multiple times already in here. Work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. Why fear and trembling? Why do we work out our salvation with fear and trembling? Because we know that it's God who works in us both to will and to do for His good pleasure. So you better, as you're working your own salvation out with fear and trembling, you better recognize that if you do anything of good for the Lord, don't get prideful. You better do it with fear and trembling because God willed it and did it in you.
That's right.
Now, we probably don't have a tough time with that. Here's where we have a tough time with. God's in charge of the sin in people's lives. Whoa, wait, stop. Are you saying that God makes people sin? No. I'm not saying that God makes anybody sin. As we will find out next week, God doesn't have to make any sinful person want sin.
That's right.
Okay? They want it, they love it, and they like it. But here's what God does. God is sovereignly in control of what He lets wicked sinners do. And just because a wicked sinner has something in their heart that they want to accomplish doesn't mean that God will allow them to accomplish it.
Right.
He may hold them back from what they even want. You remember the story of Abraham?
Yep.
Abraham is traveling on his way to Egypt. Shouldn't have been going to Egypt, by the way. Traveling on his way to Egypt. And he comes to this king, and he knew, if I don't lie and say this is my sister, and they're going to kill me, and the king is going to take Abimelech. Am I correct about that? Mm-hmm. Is that the king? Abimelech? This is in my notes, and this is off the dead. Grab my wife and take my wife and marry my wife, and she would be a part of his harem, and I'm dead. So he lies and says, this is my sister.
Right.
And so the king decides, well, what I'm going to do is I'm going to take her for myself. Mm-hmm. And in the middle of the night, God comes to him and says, touch her and you're dead. Touch her and you're dead. And he wakes up the next morning. And he's saying to God, God, I didn't know she was married to Abraham. And God said, I know. That's why I did not let you sin against me. Wait a minute. You mean God stepped in and violated that man's desires and will? Yes. He stepped in and said, you're not going to sin against me. Now, are there other times where God lets man sin against him? Yes, there is. Is there times where God uses sin to accomplish his purposes?
Yes.
Well, let's just go to the cross, shall we?
Yeah.
We can talk about Judas. We can talk about Pilate. We can talk about all those that were gathered against the chosen one to kill him. Do you know Jesus was murdered, right? Is murder sin?
Yes.
Was it God's will for Jesus to be murdered?
Yes.
Did God make them murder Jesus? No. They wanted to do it. God could have stopped them from doing it, but instead, He allowed them to have themselves to accomplish His purposes. Why? Because God's in control of people. He is sovereign over people. They don't just get to do whatever they want to do when they want to do it. God is in charge. He may at times... I love this illustration. This illustration helped me. When I was first trying to work through some of this stuff, this was confusing for me. And I'm like, okay, I believe, obviously, that Jesus was God's plan and he was murdered. So, yeah, I get it. God allowed evil to accomplish his purpose. And I'm like, okay, but like, what about Pharaoh? We know that God used Pharaoh to accomplish his purpose. And so I'm working through this, and I came across this wonderful illustration by A.W. Pink, and it really helps me out. And this, we'll get more into this next week, but if this is sinful man, if this is sinful man, what does the sinful man completely let go of by God do? They fall. Every time. And if God let them go completely, they would fall as far as they could completely go. Okay? But God is in charge of every single man. He's in charge of every decision they make. He's either giving them over to themselves or he's holding them back. And he's in charge of all 7 billion people on the planet the same way. And if God wants to allow this person to have themselves in order to accomplish his purposes, he simply lets them have what they want. And they will commit all kinds of atrocities under the sovereign control of God. Or God can hold them from themselves. Naturally, they want to fall. And God says, I'm not going to let you, Abimelech. I'm going to keep you from sinning against me. I'm going to hold you right here so you can't sin against me. I think one of the most famous passages of scriptures that really help us out is in the book of Genesis. So I want you to turn there. The book of Genesis, story of Joseph. Turn to chapter 45. Joseph has already been sent into slavery. He has already been lied about. Sent into prison. He's come out of prison. And now he is second in command of the entire world. Egypt was the most powerful nation on the planet. Joseph is the second most powerful person in the world. And finally, his brothers show up to get some food because there's a famine in the land. Look at verse 4. So Joseph said to his brothers, come near to me, please. And they came near. And he said, I am your brother, Joseph, whom you sold into Egypt. And now do not be distressed or angry with yourselves because you sold me here. For God sent me before you to preserve life. Turn to chapter 50. Verse 19 and 20. This is how the book of Genesis ends. Verse 18, his brothers also came, fell down before him, and they said, behold, we are your servants. They thought, my goodness, our father's dead. Now he's going to kill us for what we did to him. Look at his response. But Joseph said to them, do not fear, for am I in the place of God? As for you, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good.
Amen.
To bring about that many people should be kept alive as are today. Let me ask you a question. Does it say what you meant for evil, God turned to good?
No.
Does not say that. I have heard that verse misquoted. I cannot tell you how many times I've heard that verse misquoted. It does not say what you meant for evil, God turned to good. The action of selling Joseph into slavery from the brothers' point of view in their hearts, was it evil?
Yes.
God allowed it to happen. Was it good that God allowed it to happen? Yes, because he meant it for good. See, God had a purpose for that evil. It was not purposeless evil. Because here's our decision. If God is not in control of sinful man, then that means there is evil that is happening all over the world and there is no purpose for it. God could stop it. He wants to stop it, but he doesn't stop it. And he doesn't stop it. He has no reason. He just simply puts up his hands and says, purposeless evil. What can I do? Man has free will. I can't stop it. Or we say, God allows that horrific thing, like a brother being sold into slavery. He sovereignly allows that and ordains that because he means it for ultimate good. You see, here's what we do. We say, Oh, I don't have a problem with that story, Joseph, because we get to see the ultimate good that came from it. Oh, I don't have a problem with Jesus being murdered, because we see the ultimate good. The problem comes when we can't see the good. When we don't know what God is doing with it, we tend to think God's not doing anything with it. How can God be in control of this? So we're just going to say God's not sovereign over it because we don't get it? Again, that's not what the Reformers taught. That's not what the Reformers believed. God is in control of people. Of course, we have the story of Job. Job's servants. Guess what happened to Job's servants? They were all murdered. Every one of them. Murdered. You know what Job said? The Lord gives and the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. And you know God's response? Job did not sin or charge me with any wrong. Job said, my servants are dead. Ultimately, God's in charge of that. And God said, you didn't charge me with any wrong. God didn't have to put the murder in those men's hearts to go murder them, but God was in charge of it. Could God not have stopped it? A million ways he could have stopped it, but he didn't for a purpose. That, I've often said this. It's an extreme example, but I believe it. If somebody's going to break in my house tonight and kill my family and leave me with no children and leave me a widower, God better have a plan. He better not have allowed that thing purposelessly. No purpose for it. Sorry, Neil. I let somebody come in and kill your family and your wife. They're all dead. Your children are dead and you're dead. And I have no purpose for this. Or the only thing that will keep me going through that situation is to know God's in charge. God, I don't get it. I don't see it. My heart is failing. But I know that God has a plan. Because he's sovereign over people. And then this one. God is sovereign over the spiritual world. Satan had to go get permission to God to even come after Job. He does the first time, and then he comes back, and God basically says, well, you know Job didn't turn. He's like, yeah, but that's because you wouldn't let me attack him. And he says, okay, you can attack him, but you can't kill him. Satan doesn't get to go, well, I'm going to kill him anyway. You don't get to say that to God. God was in charge of the devil. The devil was a tool in the hand of God. You will only be allowed to do what I let you do because I'm sovereign. You can't kill Job because I got a plan. You can't kill him. Jesus spoke to demons. Guess what they did? They ran into pigs. They're scared to death of Jesus. Why? Because they know he's sovereign. You see, I'm convinced that the devil and the demons have a better doctrine of the sovereignty of God than most Christians do. Because the devil and the demons know who's in charge. That they get it. They're scared to death when Jesus of Nazareth comes walking by and they're possessing a man. Don't throw us into the pit. Don't throw us into the pit, please. All right, go in the pigs. Now, let's talk about the decree of God. Can we just agree God is sovereign over everything?
Yes.
Amen. Everything. You see, either you believe God is sovereign over everything, or you don't believe God is sovereign. And listen, I've heard people try to come up with weird definitions of God's sovereignty to say, well, but this and that, and then, but I believe God's sovereign. Well, you're going to have to change the definition of sovereign to keep believing he's sovereign if he's not in charge of everything. He's either in charge of everything, or you got to change the definition of sovereign. God is sovereign over everything, and that includes his salvation of people. Amen. God is sovereign over his salvation of human beings. Let's talk about the decree of God. The Westminster Shorter Catechism defines the decree of God like this. The decree of God is his eternal purpose, according to the counsel of his will, whereby, for his own glory, he hath foreordained whatever comes to pass. God has decreed everything that happens this day in the world. Everything. He decreed it. It is his eternal purpose, according to the counsel of his will, for his glory. He hath foreordained whatsoever comes to pass. You say, well, I don't like that Westminster Shorter Catechism thing. That's what the Presbyterians use. Okay. What about the 1689 London Baptist Confession, the oldest Baptist confession we have? Here's what they say about the decree of God. God hath decreed in himself from all eternity by the most wise and holy counsel of his own will, freely and unchangeably, all things whatsoever come to pass. Yet so as thereby is God neither the author of sin, nor does he have fellowship with any therein. So God has ordained everything that has come to pass. It is coming from his eternal, wise, holy counsel based upon his free will. It is unchangeable, whatever comes to pass. And they put the clause in there just so people aren't confused. But that does not mean he makes anybody sin. He is not the author of sin. But he has decreed whatsoever comes to pass. Four things I just want you to see. Number one, the decree of God is eternal. It is eternal. Psalm 33, verse 11. The counsel of the Lord stands forever. Forever. The plans of his heart to all generations. It is eternal. God, when did God plan out his story? Eternity past. His story has been planned out. It's not as if God is having to readjust to what humans do upon the earth. As if Adam and Eve jacked up God's plan and God had to go, uh-oh, plan B, Jesus. It was always his plan to send Jesus. Which means it was always his eternal decree for there to be sin and rebellion. There is no mercy and grace without sin. You believe God has eternally desired to pour out his mercy and grace on human beings? The only way you get that is if there's sin. Nobody gets the mercy of God and nobody gets the grace of God unless you need the mercy of God and the grace of God. These decrees were laid out before the foundation of the world. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 4. Laid out before the foundation of the world. Number two, the decrees of God are wise. Turn to Psalm 104, verse 24. O Lord, how manifold are your works. In wisdom you have made them all. Everything that God has made, everything that God does, he does in wisdom. Nothing is done in an unwise manner when God does it. Nothing. Every decree of God is infinitely wise. God decreed Jesus to be murdered. Infinite wisdom decreed that. Three, the decrees of God are free. Let me read Isaiah 40 to you, and then I'll explain what I mean when I say they are free. Isaiah chapter 40, verses 13 and 14. Who has measured the Spirit of the Lord? Or what man shows him counsel? In other words, what man gets together with God to make the plans out? No. Nobody. Whom did he consult? And who made him understand? Who taught him the path of justice and taught him knowledge and showed him the way of understanding? A bunch of rhetorical questions there, right? Basically to say, when God decrees, the only person that God consults with is God.
Right.
God freely decides what's going to happen on earth. Freely decides it. Number four, the decrees of God are absolute. Isaiah 46, verse 10. Again, we've referenced this. I just want to repeat it again. Declaring the end from the beginning, from ancient times, the things not yet done, saying, my counsel shall stand. and I will accomplish all my purpose. The decrees of God are absolute. If God decrees something, guess what? That thing that he decrees comes to pass. Every time. God never decrees something, and then that thing that he decrees fails. Here's what we need to understand about the sovereignty of God. We either believe in it, or we change the definition. We either come to an understanding that God is in charge of all things. Everything. Things we can see and things we cannot see. Whether we get it or whether we don't get it. I promise you the apostles didn't get Jesus dying when he died. They didn't get it. But it was good that it happened for them. Here's why I think people have the biggest problem with God's sovereignty. Because if God's in charge of everything, that means we're not. And that means what happens to us is ultimately in the hand of God. And that includes everything. That includes everything. We balk at that because we really like to be in control. Or let me say it this way. We really like to delude ourselves into thinking we're in control. And we're not. God's in charge of it all. He is the creator. We are the creations. And if we're not going to believe God's sovereign over everything, including his salvation, then why are we saying he's sovereign? I could spend 10 weeks just doing a Bible study on the sovereignty of God very easily. But what I just wanted us to do tonight is I just wanted us to deal with this issue before we ever go into the 5 points of Calvinism. Because we've got to start at the same place. God's sovereign over everything. And if he's sovereign over everything, that means he is sovereign over his salvation of people.